This morning, I want to come to the conclusion of this series that most of you thought that they will never end, about rhythm of revival. They're like, Vlad got in a series and he's going to preach it till the coming of Jesus Christ. Any message he has, he'll just label as the rhythm of revival, part 28. And so originally, I was put in my heart last year for these messages about the rhythm, about the momentum. And so about healing, how when we walk, we receive healing. When we know the truth, we receive freedom. How when we come to Jesus and grow in Jesus, we receive freedom from anxiety and stress. And how when we walk with our spouse, we have a process in which we see our love being revived. And then the last message is what I'm going to share in today. And so last Sunday when I was preparing, I had so much stuff for the single people that I wanted to make a message just for the singles. And I will do that sometime later. But for now, I'm going to leave the singles alone. Pastor Martin had a fantastic message a few weeks ago on do's and don'ts of dating, which would be pretty much the same thing that I would have shared. And so, and I have a lot of other messages on YouTube. So today I want to bring the series, and I believe probably it's one of the most important messages that you will hear in your life today. The problem happens with many of us is that we begin many things and then we don't bring them into completion. We start many things, but we don't bring them to the finish line. We create resolutions that they don't last very long. Many of us set up goals that they don't go anywhere. And there's different reasons for that. Sometimes there are spiritual, sometimes there are very practical reasons why many goals and many things we set in our life do not become a reality. And when we acquire experiences in which we fail to reach our goals, in which we fail to reach our desired dreams, we begin to develop within us a faith that we are doomed to fail. It becomes a stronghold. And we actually, after that, begin to live a life in automatic, and we no longer dream, we no longer aim for anything, and our life is no longer living, it's just existing. And today I want to help to break that in our life and help to encourage those dreams that have died and those who maybe have stopped dreaming or believing because of so many disappointments, as so many times you started and you never finished. I myself struggled before with finishing things. I would make a promise to God that I will do this, and 2 months later I will forget about it. I would make a promise to myself that I will, you know, read this or fast this many days, and I wouldn't finish it. And, you know, Jesus is a great example of that, because when he was dying on the cross and things were painful, you don't see Jesus screaming, "I quit." He shouted, "It is finished." And then he gave up the ghost. You have to come to the point where even when it's hard, you don't scream, "I quit." But you shout, "I finished it." Even if it was hard, even if it wasn't easy, even if it was costing you something, you have to develop within you a mindset of the finisher, not just the starter. Because if you start many things, you don't finish them. After a while, you stop starting things. You will just let life be as it is. You get married, you need to finish that. That means till death do us part. You start a reading, Bible reading plan for a year, go through that. Even when you fall, even when you slack off, when you start commitment to God, you gotta go till the end. Like Apostle Paul says, "I kept the faith, I finished that race. I have finished what God called me to do." Next thing that happens is you develop faith and you develop experience and a habit and a character and a habit within you that you're not just a starter, but you are also a finisher. Amen? Amen. Typically we go, and I mentioned this once and it's worth repeating, how this happens in our life. Everything starts with a desire. It starts with a desire or with a dream. Desire is something that you want. For example, you find yourself in debt and then you say, "I want to be free out of credit card debt." You find yourself overweight and you say, "You know what, I want to lose weight." You maybe find yourself today addicted to a certain thing and you have a desire. You say, "I want to no longer smoke. I want to read the Bible once in a year. I want to develop a lifestyle of fasting. I want to change my eating habits. I want to learn God's voice and actually hear God's voice. I want to is a very powerful stage that we all have to start with. Sometimes you have to understand is that God will not deliver people. Derek Prince says this. He says, God delivers those who are desperate. The problem with many people why they cannot experience freedom from bad habits in their life is because they don't want to. And their want is not big enough. Their parents want them to be free. Their friends want them to be free. Their pastor, priest wants them to be free. Except them, they don't want to be free. What do you do when you find yourself in an area that you know you should be free from this? You know you should change in this area, but you don't have a desire. I usually encourage people with this. Do you want to want to? When I meet with somebody who's addicted to alcohol or find themselves in a very bad habits and I find out they have no desire to be free whatsoever, I ask them the question, do you want to have a desire? And if they can start from there, God already can do a miracle. You start with a desire. Desire has to be clear. Desire has to be a clear-cut objective. It cannot be vague. It cannot be just, I just want to be more spiritual. Whatever that's supposed to mean. I just want to be closer to God. How do you measure that? You have to be very clear in what you want. When you look at this year, what do you want this year? What do you want for your family this year? What do you want for your finances this year? I remember last year, I just turned 30, came from Ukraine, and I gained substantial amount of weight. I didn't realize, you know, you don't realize how it gets on you. It just kind of grew with it, and my pastor gave my wife an advice. He said, your husband, help your husband. He needs to lose some weight. You know, and that's hurts, you know, when your own pastor doesn't see you as beautiful. And I stepped on the scale and I measured my weight according to my height and everything, and I realized I am 2 pounds away from being overweight. And so then I got a clear-cut goal, very clear, of how much pounds I want to lose. It was very clear. It was not just a desire, I want to be this. It was a clear-cut goal of what I wanted. The Bible says faith is substance of things. Faith is not substance of I want everything. No, things. Specific, clear-cut. Blind Bartimaeus came to Jesus and said, Jesus, have mercy on me. Jesus says, what do you want? Mercy. He says, what do you want? I want to see. He said, okay, we can work with that. And many of us, that's exactly what we do with God. We say, God, bless me. And God says, what does that mean? Well, you know, Lord. He says, I do, but do you know what you want? God is not asking you so that he can get. No, God knows your heart. God wants you to know what you want. That's why he asked Solomon, what do you want? He said, Daniel, you're a man of desire. What do you want? For example, I want very clearly. I don't want the whole world to be saved. That's a desire that God has. My desire is I want to see 1,000 souls saved. That's measurable and that is a concrete, clear goal. I want to see 1,000 souls being healed, 1,000 bodies being healed this year. That's what I want. I want to see 30 people in our internship this year. I want to see a movement of hundreds of kids during this summer from the Yogi Bear. That's what I want. I want to see teenagers preaching once a month in our youth service and becoming young men and women of God. That's what I want. I want our CD when it's going to be released, A Race to Deliver, to begin to impact the Christian world. That's what I want. I want a specific clear-cut goals, and this is where it starts with everything. Your faith cannot grow if you don't know what you want. Most of us have been convinced that our wants are wrong. I want to convince you that your wants are weak. God wants a desire that is strong within you, a burning desire. Do you want to be set free from smoking? Do you want to pay off your consumer debt? Do you want to lose weight, for example? Do you want to see your family come to Jesus Christ? What do you want? This is where you have to start with. After you figure out what you want, you go to step number two is you decide. You make a decision. You say, I will. I will. Decision is very powerful because God will honor decision. The problem with many of us why we don't like to make decisions is because we are so worried about the details and the complications that making this decision will bring into our life. What will happen? If I choose to read the Bible, where will I have the time? If I choose, you know, if I want to lose weight, you know, but what do I do? And we get so worked up about the details the decision will bring, not realizing when you make a decision, God releases grace to deal with details. God won't give you the grace to deal with details until you make up your mind, I will do that. When Daniel went to the Babylonian kingdom and Daniel made a decision, I will not eat of the foods offered to idols. Well, he could have gotten killed for that decision, but Daniel let the worries about the details come after the decision. And it's interesting, God gave him wisdom on how to present his plan of not eating those foods. And not only God gave him wisdom, God gave him favor, and he got fatter from eating good foods, not skinnier. That was in old days, that was actually good. It's interesting, everybody was trying to get lighter in the Old Testament and bigger, and it seems like everything is opposite. Trends change. That's for free on the side. But the point is that when he makes a decision, God works out the details. When you make a decision, God will work out the details. When you make a decision that I'm going to pursue this, you know, like the decision that we made to go to a Toyota Center, you have no idea how many times during the week I get panic attacks from Toyota Center. Seeing that how many people registered for our conference right now, even this morning when I would sit in my chair and turn on the music and close my eyes and I imagine Toyota Center, and literally I have fears that nobody will come, that you won't even come. A Valentine's banquet yesterday, you know, a lot of our people didn't come, and I was like, Toyota Center is going to be duplication of the Valentine's banquet. And so guess what happened? But we made a decision, and because we made a decision, you're going to have to go through the details, work them out, and God will come through for them. When I made a decision last year, and when I came from the Ukraine, that's it, in this month I'm going to lose 10 pounds. What am I going to do? Am I going to go starve myself to death? But see, right away you get ideas on how you're going to go about it. I said, I'm going to run every few days. I'm going to stop eating after 7. I will drink water every day, and I will cut my portions. Small little things that God will give you wisdom, but he won't give you the wisdom until you make up your mind on what you're going to do. God is not going to make a decision for you. You have to make a decision. Can somebody say amen? I remember fellowshipping with Anna and Mike yesterday after the banquet, and Anna came and gave her life to the Lord. Pastor Ilya was preaching one of these Sundays, and Anna came and she gives her life to the Lord, surrenders her life to Jesus. And then me and Lana met with Anna afterwards and find out she has a boyfriend that she graciously lives with, and he wants to move out of town for a job, and she makes a decision right there and then. She says, I'm not moving out of town because I'm going to stay in this church so I can get grounded. I'm like, well, your boyfriend might leave you. She said, you know what? Whatever be, but I'm not leaving this town because I want to be rooted in God. It's interesting that that boyfriend that she had that was leaving out of town because of a job, he starts to come. In a few weeks, he gives his life to Jesus. He makes a decision not to move out of town. And that job moved from that place to this town, and everything got worked out. Make a decision. Somebody say decision. When you make a decision, details work themselves out. Many of you, you come to church, but you are afraid to make a decision to make Jesus the Lord of your life. You're like, what? I have to give up this. I'll have to give up that. Does that mean I'll have to speak in tongues? Does that mean that I'll have to raise my hands? And you worry about the details. Let the details be. Make a decision and you will find the grace to work out the details in Jesus' name. The third step happens when you make a decision, and this is the painful part, what we're going to talk about today, is that the feelings that accompanied you when you made a decision will last there for a few days, sometimes weeks, and after that, people typically hit what Seth Godin, the leadership guru, calls it the dip, or this dry spell, or this wilderness where you have to no longer rely on, I want to do this. You have to say, I must do this. Means your feelings, what you decided to do, are gone. You're looking at that activity that you said, you promised that I'm going to tithe every month, and then first week was exciting. You get good feelings. The second week was fine, and the third week you're like, I'm not even going to church today. I'm not tithing. Why tithing? I could buy so much with that. And then you're looking at your other friends, they're like, they're not tithing and they're just fine. And guess what, you make a decision, you're like, I'm going to quit tithing. What point from tithing? What's the point of going to church? People don't even like me there. What's the point of depriving myself from those foods? I mean, I'm gonna still die. If it's God's will for me to die, I'm gonna die. Gym? Who cares about gym? And then you're looking at the date nights with your spouse, you're like, that's the biggest waste of time. We're just gonna get a TV dinners and watch our TV show. And then you begin to drop the towel because the feelings you had when you make a decision disappeared. And you're not the only one. It's not because you're crazy. It's not because you don't care. It's not because you're not spiritual. Even Jesus had good feelings when he said, I'm gonna go die for humanity. When it came to actually dying, in the garden, Bible gives us exclusive look at his prayer. He said, Father, not what I want, indicates I don't want to do this. Jesus in heaven said, Father, I want to do this. Came down on earth, spent 33 years with us, the crazy people. He said, Father, don't want to do this. Let them all burn in hell. They're crazy. Judas is nuts. Peter is crazy. Everybody crazy. Father, I don't want to do this. You will come to a time where what you've decided to do, you're gonna say like Jesus, Father, don't want to do this, but not what I want, what I must. If you don't come to that point, and if you just simply throw the towel and says, oh, I don't want to, so I quit. No. It's not, you're not crazy. You're just like Jesus. If you lost the want, switch to a second wind, second gear. I must. I have to do this. I don't want to do this. I don't feel like doing this. The world is breaking against me. I have to do this. I have to take my family to church on Sunday morning. I have to fast. I have to give. I have to witness. I have to believe and dream for 1,000 souls to be saved this year. I have to. Everything inside of me says, this is not gonna happen. You crazy. What do you think? I mean, people don't even want to be a part of this. I know I must be about my Father's business. I must. When that kicks in, you're operating no longer on emotion. You're operating on some spiritual power that is coming from the Holy Ghost. Can somebody say amen? And after I must, you go on that not for too long, and then you switch, where inside you begin to delight in what you used to endure. You actually begin to enjoy doing the very things you had to endure. The Bible says Jesus, he endured the cross for the joy that was set before him. You begin to enjoy, you know that time in fasting, first day of fasting, you're excited toward the evening. You're like, that is the dumbest idea. Whoever fasts, I'm sure Pastor Vlad is not fasting right now. And then the next day you recognize everyone else that is spiritual in the church. They ain't fasting because they're posting pictures. You're like, you know what? I'm not doing this. This is not from God. God, I'm like, I'm mad. Like, I was normal before I was fasting. And now I'm crazy. But see, and when you get through that little crazy moment, that tension, and we all experience in everything we make a decision, you experience this beautiful feeling when delight comes in. When you now love doing what you dreaded, what you hated, what you didn't like it. You're like, that's not me. I'll never like it. You begin to enjoy that. And then comes the most beautiful point, is you begin to see the difference in your life because of that decision. You begin to see your life change. You begin to step on a scale and the numbers are different. You begin to read the Bible, and you were reading the Bible reading plan, and for weeks you're falling asleep reading it, but now it's reading you. Things stand out from the scriptures. You begin to look at your relationship and you recognize you're no longer two strangers sharing the same last name. You begin to notice beautiful thing in the face of the other person. You begin to sense changes. You begin to notice people are getting healed. You were always praying for that, but now you're not just praying for people, you're seeing the results. You begin to notice things are shifting and things are changing in your finances. That debt that it seems so huge, you're noticing one more month and baby, we're out of debt completely. You begin to notice a change in your life. See, God doesn't throw the change right after you make a desire. God doesn't throw that, otherwise everyone would be changed. The change is a process, because in all of this process, something develops within you that is important to maintain the change you receive. The reason why God takes us through this of breaking points and breaking periods is because God isn't interested in giving you something you do not know how to maintain. And when you go through that, things in you will die. Things in you will rise again. And through that, you will be able to be equipped to maintain the very blessing God brings through this process. The most beautiful part, it's not where it ends, is the fact that you have destiny, meaning you leave a legacy for your children. Your ceiling becomes their floor. Now they only see prosperity. They see good decisions. They don't know what it's like to borrow money because you show them how to sacrifice money. They don't know how to see how people fight because you've shown love in relationship. They don't know what it's like not to read the Bible. To them, it's normal to see both parents reading the Bible. To them, it's normal. We have time during the month where we abstain from food completely. Why? Because we dedicate ourselves to God. They see that as a normal. They don't have to even fight for it. It's already injected as a generational blessing. That's why God told to Abraham, he says, what I'm teaching you, it's not just for you, it's for your children and your grandchildren. So you will pass it on to generations yet unborn. But I want to talk about the point that really kills all of us. And that's point number three. It's when we make a decision or we made a promise to God, we made a promise to one another, and then afterwards we hit this season where the feelings have faded away, and on the opposite, we feel so convinced we should give that up. Or maybe we've been doing it for some time and there is no sign of changing. Things are actually only getting worse, and you feel like if you would just quit, things will get better. There's a picture of, you guys probably saw the picture of two people digging a tunnel in under the ground, and in that picture one person quits right before having the breakthrough and the other person keeps plowing. That's us in January, and that's us in February when it comes to fitness. For many of us, this is a beautiful picture. I want to teach you something this morning. When you discipline yourself, when you believe, when you have that dream, when you have that goal, put like a stamp, postage stamp on the letter. It sticks to the letter until that letter comes to its destination. If somebody rips off the postage stamp from the letter gets lost. There are people in this room, you're lost. And it's not because you're in sin. It's because the postage stamp means God's stamp on your life, God's desire for you, God's dream for you, God's goal for you. You've allowed circumstances, your bad habits, to rip that out of the envelope of your destiny. And today you're just cruising around. You're not reaching no longer your destiny. You're circling around, and you're not gonna arrive on accident until the Holy Spirit in this service puts that stamp postage again on your letter and says, listen, stick to this until it arrives at the desired destination. But what if my life will never change? What if I'm gonna believe for the salvation of my family and I will die and nothing will happen? But things are only getting worse, Vlad. Joseph had a moment where things were getting bad, really bad, really bad, really bad, and then they got so bad that it seems like it can't get worse than this. And Joseph kept doing the right thing. He kept doing the right thing. He kept doing the right thing, and he kept doing the right thing. He translates the dreams for other people until one night, and there came a tipping point in the spiritual world where the Pharaoh gets a dream. And everything was positioned, and Joseph gets invited. And see, Joseph had small little breakthroughs, but he would have a one step forward, three steps backwards. And that's how his life was always. For years, for decades, it's been like this. But this time, he steps into the Pharaoh's court to translate the dreams. And he doesn't just take a step forward and then takes three steps backwards. He takes a step forward, another step forward, another step forward. And from that point on, Joseph never went back to his past. I believe in spiritual world, there is tipping points where you have been faithful. You have been faithful. You prayed. You saw a little change, but nothing dramatic. And there comes a tipping point where things shift. And once they shift, they never, ever go back. Hallelujah. It's Moses in Egypt. He's giving one plague to Pharaoh and Pharaoh budges a little bit. Gives another plague and Pharaoh doesn't respond. A third plague, a fourth plague, a fifth plague, and it seems like there is nothing that can move this Pharaoh. And another plague and another plague, and it seems like, you know what, God, these plagues aren't working. And God tells Pharaoh, Moses, he tells Moses first, he says, after this plague, he will let you go. There comes a plague. There comes a tipping point, a breaking point. When you reach that, it seems like all of these little things, they had no meaning whatsoever. They didn't do anything. You knew it was right. You knew God was behind it. You knew what God wanted you to do, but there was no results. But there comes the plague number 10. And in that plague, Pharaoh will plead with you to leave. And things shift. And you never, ever go back to Egypt. But see, if you leave Egypt on the plague number 8, because you said, this is pointless. This is not going to happen. You know what? I've been doing this. You know what? This is not work. If you drop this whole process, you will leave before you break through. See, a boiling point in water is when the heat with the same temperature keeps boiling water, and then that water evaporates. See, your discipline, your commitment, your loyalty to God, your dream, your sacrifices, they are boiling your circumstances, and they're only bubbly, but there comes a boiling point when that bubbly is no longer bubbly, it becomes vapor. And the circumstances, they drastically change. And nothing different you did, except a tipping point has come into your life. Ask the widow who came to an unjust judge. And she told him, please defend me. And the judge wouldn't budge. And there came that one more time she came. It was like another time. But in the spiritual world, it wasn't another time. It was the breaking point. What the judge says, I will help you. I want to encourage people today in this room. There is a breaking point where your life drastically changes. It doesn't just happen when you expect it. That's why you can't give up, because the time you thought it will take for you to get to that point has expired. Because the enough oil you had to reach the bridegroom, you notice the bridegroom isn't coming on time. You have to wait not until your time you've set in your heart expires, but until the bridegroom comes. Don't leave Saul when 7 days pass. Leave only when Samuel comes. Disciples were told, wait for the Holy Spirit. And as they waited one day, second day, third day, and next thing that happens is on a day 10, the Holy Spirit came. Changes happen. Their life was never the same. Your life will change. Mordecai was a man who, things were so bad for him. There was this anti-Semitism operating in Babylon against him. And he was such a big enemy. And Haman wanted to kill him. Haman already created a huge place where he's going to hang Mordecai. Mordecai was approaching his death. But see, when you live your life right before God, and things don't work out, there is a God who sits on a throne. He's the maker of heaven and the earth, and he holds the universe in the palm of his hand. And he orders seasons, and he shifts times. Times are in his hand. Your enemy doesn't have a grip on your life, even if it feels like God is sovereign. And in that night, God gives a sleepless night to a king. And when kings would have a sleepless night, they would read him a chronicles of the history. It's like a phone book. This is another way to put this king back to sleep. And as they were reading the chronicles, this was just another thing to put him back to sleep. And they stumbled upon an event where Mordecai saved his life. And the king, who wasn't asleep, said, what was done for Mordecai? See, the enemy already plotted his funeral. But a man lived obedient and obedient and obedient and obedient to God until came a tipping point. And next morning, this Mordecai, he wasn't hanged. He was ridden on a mule and people bowed before him. And that enemy of his was executed. And Mordecai was promoted and Mordecai was honored. And never again Mordecai went back to being humiliated. When God orders the change of your seasons, it will not come sometimes when you expect it, but it will come. When you were struggling with finances, and you did what was right, and you may say, but what else can I do? Hang in there. Because God, who holds the seasons in His time, He will shift the seasons. And when they shift, your life will change. Amen. When we were praying for salvation of people, for many, many years, fasting, spreading flyers, and people said that people won't get saved in a Russian church. At the time it was more Russian than now. People will not come to a church that doesn't speak well English. Interesting part is that there is a God in heaven and He shifts seasons. I remember on one Thursday, the youth service, where a guy named Chad, he came to the youth service and he was the first person that got saved. And I remember we baptized him. Today Chad serves God in the local church here. He is married. He has children, and God greatly impacted his life. But that tipping point that happened on our youth service brought something inside of our spirit that said, people will be saved in our church. And from that point on, we became mad, crazy, passionate. This is possible. This is what's going to happen. And even when we had seasons where maybe somebody wasn't getting saved, we already experienced a tipping point for which we're not going back. This year we're going to experience another tipping point where we're going to see 1,000 souls come to know the Lord. It will build a faith in us that we didn't have before, that nothing is impossible to God. I remember when about 4 years ago that a gentleman, a pastor, prayed for me so God will use me to heal people. And after I came back home, I decided to start praying for the sick every single service. The first service, you know, I expected after first service when I prayed for the sick, because I felt the anointing, people will respond and saying, I got healed. Nothing happened. Second month, nothing happened, to the point where I remember one Sunday, there was very few of us, and I was so shy to pray for the sick. I was like, there is no sick people, and if they are, it is not the Lord's will to heal them. They're not gonna get healed. And just to go through the motion, because I made a promise to God, I said, I'm just gonna pray for the sick again. Nothing happened, just like I expected, until I went to Seattle. It was a GC conference, one small conference in a very small room. And I did my thing, which I promised to God, I'm gonna pray for the sick. I prayed for the sick. I didn't even ask for testimonies because I was convinced there was none. Months later, a lady with her husband comes to our prayer line. And as her husband begins to share how they're coming for their son to receive prayer, he says, by the way, we were at this conference in this little upper room in Seattle, and my wife had a scheduled doctor's appointment to examine her shoulder and to probably operate on her shoulder. And when you were there, you said for people to pray for their body parts that were hurting. And when she did that, she felt heat going through her body. And she is here today. It's been 2 months. She never went back to the doctor for that. She is completely healed. This is the lady. This was the tipping point for me. From that point on, I realized God is going to use me to heal people. Even when we had months where I didn't see testimonies, but that tipping point, I in my mind recognized my life is no longer a life where healings don't happen, period. Things shifted. And they even happened where last week I was in California, start praying for the viewers, and God gave me just a picture of what's going to happen. And a lady was supposed to come today from Spokane, but something happened where she received complete healing over the live stream. People start coming right after that service, even in the studio, testifying that God healed them. And every time I pray, I see God heals people. Why? Because a season shifted. It wasn't anything particular. It wasn't in any special prayer. It's just when you do the right thing, you boil the water till the point where the water turns into vapor and your season changes.
That's why I want to encourage you. Maybe today you are like Moses. You're keeping your hands up and your hands are tired. Maybe your faith is tired. Maybe even this message provokes you because you're like, Vlad, I already gave up and Lazarus stinks. And you're coming and you want to raise him up. I'm coming like Aaron and Hur. I want to lift your hands. I want to hold your hand so that your hand will see complete victory over the Amalek in your life. God has a change of seasons. God has a change of seasons in your finances. God has a change of seasons in your health. God has a change of seasons in your emotional life, in your spiritual life. Some of you just gave up too soon. You quit too early. You ripped the stamp out of the letter and the letter is going nowhere right now. And you're thinking you're just cruising through life. You are mad at yourself because you know there is more to life than what you're doing today. I want to bring hope inside of you today through the Holy Spirit and tell you, rise up and tell you, you can do it through the grace of God. If you quit something that you know God called you to keep doing, pick that up today. Pick that up today because there is great reward in your faith. Don't quit too early. Don't give up too soon. In Jesus' name. Amen. In the conclusion, the first point that I wanted you to make, how to maintain in this season, your environment is very important. Meaning when you go through that and it's very hard, protect your environment. When you protect your environment will protect your faith. Many people do not understand, but creating an environment during the time when you're believing for something from God is more important than actually your faith, because your environment will guard your faith when your faith is at its weakest. Environment is church. Environment is at home. Put some podcasts, put some messages, put some spiritual food around you. When your faith is on life support, make sure you feed that faith. Protect your environment. Bananas cannot grow in Alaska for one reason, because of environment. There are certain things cannot survive, and many times when our faith hits the weakest and you're literally it's going on its last limb, what could help you get through that is if you force yourself to be in an environment that sustains your faith instead of ruins it. Amen. The second thing is you have to keep your focus in the midst of distractions. Keep your focus in the midst of distractions. The way Elisha received the anointing from Elijah, actually he was receiving his spirit, means he wanted to receive what was inside of Elijah, and Elijah gave him a challenge. He says, and when you see me taken, you will have what you ask for. Meaning if you want to have a different spirit inside, if you want to be a different man, Elisha, that's really hard, but I'm giving you a challenge. When you see me taken, I mean, how hard is it to see somebody being taken? I mean, we watched the Taken movie, right? It's not very hard to see somebody being taken, except there's a problem. They're walking together and the chariot of fire comes in between them. Now, when a chariot walks in between you and the chariot of fire, you get your eyes off the prize, which is Elijah, and you start watching a flaming, exciting chariot. And that was the temptation. I saw that today during prayer, as they were fixing the chandelier during morning prayer, how many people's eyes, people just stop praying. That was the distraction. That means have moments throughout the day in your life. That doesn't mean you can have to be focused 24/7 only on your goal. That's not possible. You're gonna have to be focused on other things. But focus on your goal when you spend time with God. Focus on Jesus when you spend time with God. During that time, when you have the time with the Lord, focus on what the Lord wants to do through you. During that time, focus. Throughout the day, you will be distracted with other things. But during your time with the Lord, focus on your dream. Literally, laser focus. Successful man is an average man focused. Jesus says narrow way leads to life, meaning when you focus your life, when you spend time with him, you revive those dreams and they become alive throughout the day. How I do that practically is that in my time with the Lord, I try to have music that really ministers to my emotion. I close my eyes and I imagine all of those seven things this year I'm believing for. I imagine them and I create a live image I tried to create a live image of people walking into the Toyota Center during the Race to Deliver conference and lifting their hands. I create a live image of that room being completely packed with 30 kids. I create a live image of kids running around, playing, laughing during the summer in the gym. I create a live image of Zachy, Eric, Angela, and others rising up and speaking words of healing. I create a live image of the Holy Spirit moving and creating miracles in people's lives. And I create, sometimes it takes 2-3 minutes, I keep that image alive there. It quickens my emotions. I want to pray for something else. When you do that every few times a week, something inside of you changes, your spirit changes, because you were focused on that. And lastly, keep hitting the ground until you break through. Don't quit when you get tired. The way Elisha transferred his mantle to a king is he gave him a test. He says, if you keep hitting, you are going to win. But he didn't tell him when to stop. And the king stopped at 3 times, and Elisha got mad, and he says, if you would have hit to 5 or 6, you would have gotten complete victory, meaning your life will drastically, dramatically change. You stopped too early. Don't stop when you get tired. Stop when you win. Because a tipping point happens in your life. It will happen if you don't give up. How many of you watched Super Bowl last Sunday? Father, I thank you for a spiritual church. Amen. How many of you were praying secretly? I mean, even if you're a Patriot hater, you just hate Patriots. But secretly, you were hurting for them when they were suffering. It was never happened in a football game before when the team was so behind in points. But there came a point in that game where a point switched. When they got their interception and something inside, you could see in their eyes, something inside of them rose up. And not only they beat the other team, but they set the record. If they could do it with a piece of cloth full of air, you can do it with your life, with the power of the Holy Spirit. Can somebody say amen? I want us to believe for miracles today. I want us to pray for miracles today. Something that 2 weeks ago when I went for my prayer time, I felt in my heart to start praying for bizarre miracles in our church. Unexplainable things like missing stuff to begin to reappear again. Supernatural loss of weight. Supernatural growth of hair. Supernatural dental work by the Holy Spirit. Where God will cause money to appear in your account for no reason. If He could do it in the mouth of the fish, He can do it in the Giza checking account. For God to supernaturally begin to take away the debts, you might say that just can't happen. With the God who has access to everything, He can begin to shift things. And I believe today we're going to take time to pray for that in Jesus' name. We're going to also pray today, but God's going to be healing people who have asthma, bronchitis, or shortness of breath. People either who are watching live or even here, we're going to agree that the Holy Spirit will do miracles in this place. Why? Because we are His children. Why? Because we are people of faith. Why? Because the Spirit of the living God who raised Christ from the dead lives inside of you, and He lives inside of me. Can somebody say amen? I believe somebody here today, you gave up. And you came to the service, not for the service, you came for some other reason. But even during this time right now, God supernaturally will lift your weak hands that have been weakened, and you will receive complete victory over the Amalek in your life, in Jesus' name.